Hello everyone, welcome back to Verdant Interviews for episode number 4 today. Today's guests we have Joe Magestro and Brian Edward of Mythicist Milwaukee. This will be our second conversation with one another. Our first conversation was episode number 2 of Verdant Interviews where we talked about religion and religious dogmatism. If you'd like to learn more about them or Mythicist Milwaukee, I'd highly recommend you go check that episode out. For today's conversation, we're going to be shifting into the realm of non-religious, aka political dogmatism. We'll be bringing up different concepts such as tribalism, us versus them mentality, identity politics, as well as the great schism that's been currently happening in the United States the past couple of years on the political landscape. I'm sure you've all noticed it. So I think we had a great conversation today. We got a lot out of it, a lot of interesting discussion. I'm sure you all will love it. And without further ado, let's dig right into it. You listen to Verdant Interviews. This is your host, Ken Verdant. We're back here for our unofficial part 2 with Mythicist Milwaukee with Joe Magestro and Brian Edward. Guys, thanks for coming on to the show again.
How you doing?
Yeah, thanks. Our pleasure.
Alrighty, so everyone that's been keeping up thus far, I think we all know about you guys and Mythicist Milwaukee, so let's get right into the meat and potatoes of this.
Sounds good.
So we talked about religious dogmatism last time, and this time we're going to go into non-religious dogmatism, in other words, political dogmatism, and everything that has to do with that. So I'd like us to start off, before we get into each of these major concepts, which I plan for the major concepts we're going to be talking about today to be like identity politics, obviously dogmatism, and other things of that nature, and other ideologies that have existed in the past and continue to exist in the modern political landscape. So with religious dogmatism and non-political dogmatism, let's break down what the difference is and what just dogmatism is. So would you like introducing us on what your thoughts are on just dogmatism?
I would think dogmatism, at least to me, is this fierce loyalty to a very strict loyalty to a rigid system of codes. So whatever it is, whatever the value sets are, you have to believe them. You feel compelled to defend them even when there's some external evidence that feels weird. So you want to follow that. That's tribal. The loyalty to your football team is kind of one that, you know, is kind of, you know, without, it's, what's the word? Innocent, if you will.
Innocent, you know, benign form of dogma.
Benign, yeah. Benign form of dogma.
Okay. Yeah, I think at the end of the day, the difference between religious dogmatism and we'll say any other type of dogmatism is literally just the subject. When you talk about, you know, I know a lot of skeptics like to think because I'm a skeptic or because I'm not religious, that's not mean I'm dogmatic towards anything. You know, I broke that, which isn't the point anymore. We have people who are clearly on both sides not paying attention to their beliefs being challenged, and they don't care. And I think that just comes along the line of it's almost, I want to say it as a survival instinct of humans. We can only do so much. We can only check so much each and every day. We have to be comfortable with where we are. And if we're not comfortable, we can't enjoy our life. So when we almost have that type of dogmatism, it's because we have that kind of dissonance come to us, but we prefer not to look at it because it's more comforting to us to have these beliefs that are already set.
Yeah, and I think it goes farther in such like the religious dogmatism. If you were a hardcore Christian, for example, and somebody criticized Jesus or the church, you might very well take it that they're criticizing you. And if somebody goes on a diatribe about President Bush, you consider yourself a Republican, you voted for him, you might think you're talking about me. You'll take that very personally. And that, I don't think it's necessarily meant personally, but That's what happens, and that's why atheists and Christians can go at it as well as, you know, blue and red on the political side.
Well, I think it also comes to where basically pride comes from as well with people. We don't want to be wrong at the end of the day. We have to be right because we don't want to feel stupid. We don't want to feel inadequate compared to everyone else on an intellectual level. And the moment you criticize someone's beliefs, even for probably more open-minded people like us, there's still that little bit of fire that kind of brews when we're said we're wrong, because we don't want to be wrong, because it kind of hurts our reputation that we know that. So I think a lot of it has to do with pride and people not willing to give up that step because they don't want to feel inadequate compared to the rest of their friends and family or even coworkers or whatever group they want to be associated with.
Yeah, I really think, too, that political beliefs, in a way, are morals. And no one wants to be immoral. Even those committing murder and genocide in the Bible, even, you know, they're doing it for a moral cause. That everything is, you know, one person's war of aggression is another person's, you know, campaign. So the fact that if you're wrong politically, you may be wrong morally. And the last thing you want to think of is I'm immoral, especially when you think you're a good person. Most people think they're good people.
And I think one thing that we do need to keep in track of when it comes to dogmatism, especially things more nuanced like politics, just because someone heavily disagrees with you does not mean they're dogmatic. Mm-hmm. And that gets thrown out a lot on both sides, which is actually very interesting to look at, because you have people on the left and the right saying the other side is completely closed-minded. They're not willing to listen to facts. They're scared. They want their feelings okay instead of facing the truth. But both sides are saying it, and both are calling each other dogmatic too. So you can't throw around dogma or dogmatic or whatever you want to say to the person like it's just a random pejorative. You have to actually mean and pay attention to who you're calling dogmatic or what you're calling as dogma.
Yeah, I think you both bring up a lot of good points with that too, and especially when you can just see this conflict of morals and values with people even among the same families, where that's why people say things such as we don't talk politics and religion at the dinner table. And it's why so many people just cannot communicate these ideas in an efficient way that doesn't result in arguing or extreme emotional distress. And even when you get more lumped into a certain value system that you're looking at, I think that you can be more susceptible to having an extreme emotional response, just even having something as a name or a newspaper or someone appear on screen or just a general template of an idea or an identity laid out. It's you have a complete know-how of how everyone, like this person, this group of people act. And that can create such divides between people too. And it's something that getting past this is a huge step. And I think that one of the first things I'd like to bring up is tribalism and how that relates to dogmatism here. So when I look at tribalism, it's, as you might imagine, it's almost like a part of the human nature response to these things. And we want to be around people we can agree with, and we don't want to have cognitive dissonance. So I want to get your continued thoughts on this tribalism and how do you think it's part of human nature too?
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. I mean, look at your general circle of friends, whether it's you two or any listeners, you know, at home. It's hard to be friends with someone who morally is opposed to almost anything or everything that you believe in. And that's just because it's straining. It strains the relationship and it strains you. So the idea of making, we'll say, echo chambers or making those tribes of beliefs, it's a completely natural thing because, like I said before, it all comes down to not being overwhelmed with life, just trying to make sense and bring on day by day. If you try to go on before that or more than that, that's when things start getting rough and start to overwhelm the host, I would think, personally.
Yeah, we're not really evolved for the situation that we're in. You know, we grew up in, you know, if you're sitting back in 50,000 BC and you're living in your maybe 150 person tribe, the last thing you want to do is get kicked out of the tribe. You're screwed. You're going to get eaten by a saber-toothed tiger or you're going to die. It's not good. The next tribe is probably not going to take you. Like, so the groupthink and this idea of wanting to belong, even denying reality to want to belong, makes a lot of sense. I mean, we're not evolved to handle nuclear weapons either. You know, that we have them. So I think what we have to do is learn how to deal better with where we're at. Because we do have an enormously powerful, you know, militaries. We have enough weapons to destroy the world. You know, we have there's a lot that can happen, and I think we just have to be aware of it. Just like we're aware of with the Holocaust Museum, when things could go wrong, like a country like Germany, a first world country, just going berserk, you know, and somehow descending into that. Like, how could that happen? But it does, and that's, I think we just have to know our nature.
Yeah, it certainly seems that with people feel like they don't have a choice when it comes to acting in a tribalistic manner, and it's why certain communities will stick together. Even when people don't agree with the values of their community, they might have already established emotional or force. And in case, like, if you're just in the family, that's a force connection that you want to stick with these people. If you're with these people, you're going to survive. So it seems that tribalism is something that's part of our evolution and just nature again. And I think that with this new age of communication, there's so many more people we can connect with and so many more people that we can identify with that we didn't know we can connect with now. And I think that's creating a lot of situations among individuals where they just don't know how to react. Where, okay, I have this whole group of friends online that agree with maybe this value that I have that I thought everyone around me doesn't agree with. It can be something as mundane as just sharing a hobby, or it can be something as big as your entire political identities. And it's kind of like a positive and negative, where now it's so easy to cut additional people off from your life sharing a similar political ideology. And because you can readily identify just more people that are willing to jump into that same echo chamber with you. And that goes for both sides, or really any side that might exist. And for the people that are being honest, it's even hard that once you start trying to find what you find to be the morally correct ideology to follow, identifying like what makes those ideologies unique, having a full comprehension of like what are the values you believe in, and the people that follow your ideology, are they all having the same values, or is it something that's more wishy-washy, or we don't really have an established ideology?
Well, you said a lot, so I'm going to try taking it. I'm going to back up a little bit to what you said before, where people aren't aware of who they agree with and who they don't agree with. And then with social media, kind of completely burst that bubble. The first thing that came to my mind was when I had a bunch of friends who were in complete disbelief when Trump became president, like probably all of us. But their reasoning was, I don't know how he became president. I have never met a single person who would vote for Trump. Well, of course you didn't, because you don't want to be associated around those types of people. They completely disagree with you. So you've unintentionally created an echo chamber for yourself. So I think not necessarily, I want to go with reverse or opposite of what you said before, Ken, where it's, I don't think social media is necessarily showing people as much of what we do agree with, which is, I mean, it's true, that happens. But I think it's showing people that we disagree more than we do agree. Because before, back, we'll say, when I was younger, back in the 90s, you're right, we did not talk about religion. We did not talk about politics, because those were ideas off the table, because you did not want to upset someone. But now when everyone has a platform, you can't silence the information anymore. There's just no way around it. Some of your best friends may turn out to be really horrible people that you don't agree with at all. But you have never known that beforehand, because they never had a platform to talk to you. So I think that, and that's coming as a real big shock for people that they can't handle right now. And it may not be for a while until they can eventually handle it.
Yeah, I think that's the other thing. You could either A, be in your echo chamber and have never met a Trump voter, or you had, but you don't know you had. You know, I mean, what if you think about it, if you were in a church and people were saying, I don't know, you're 18 and you're with your parents and people are saying, do you believe in premarital sex? I don't know. You know, they're not going to say it there. But if you got that person in an environment where they felt more comfortable, they might give you a different answer. And they're like, well, why are we having such a problem with teenage pregnancy when no one believes in premarital sex? Okay, that's because you're not getting a good sample. And I think that's the problem. When you can tell when you're in a group, you kind of want to conform. So one of the ways to conform is not to lie, but just to shut up. You know, and then you can nod along. No one's going to know. And you think, well, why do I want to piss these people off? I don't want to be the only one here.
Correct. And I think it's a lot of people just wanting to avoid conflict in general, too. Where, say, someone like you or me, Brian, where we love being wrong. We love discussing things. Mm-hmm. someone who maybe not be as well versed in certain topics wouldn't feel comfortable to even say anything because they don't want to cause that conflict to begin with without being able to back themselves up. So I get it, but at the same time, it's still causing the problem we have today. We have to be able to create this, we'll say, society where people are more than willing to be wrong and more than willing to listen to their side than ever before. Because if we don't, we're plunging into literal chaos right now where people are thinking the other side is literally the most dangerous threat to our country at this moment. And they're literally just our neighbors, where they probably agree with us more often than not, but they're not willing to discuss them.
And that's where we're suffering from an enormous lack of nuance. Correct. Right? I mean, the word alt-right, even Nazi being thrown around, extreme rights, white supremacist, those people do exist. I looked at, I think it was Reuters poll, or was it Pew? One of the two. At actual white supremacy in the United States. And the highest state was Idaho. By maybe not surprising to some people, at 8 per 100,000. So even by Idaho's standards, let's say Idaho's every state, and we take 8 per 100,000, multiply it out, we got about 30,000. Not that many, or 24. It's not a ton. So the actual number of real white supremacists is maybe 15,000. That's smaller than my hometown. That's not, but I've heard stuff on social media. There's the Nazis that they're your fathers. They're your sons. They're your cousins. They're your teachers, your coworkers. I mean, this is fear mongering in the hugest part. I mean, anyone's going to say white supremacy is a good thing. No, it's not. And to be honest, you got to almost excise that from the political discussion. Those people can help from maybe de-radicalization, but really you can cut those out of the political fold. But there's a big problem when you go witch hunting and take your average garden variety conservative or just somebody who totally agrees with Fox News and say, that's an alt-righter. That's not an alt-righter. That's a conservative or a hardcore Republican. And we have big problems there.
Yeah, you bring up a good point, too, when it comes to these identities about how people will assume that if they're not part of the identity, they still know what makes those people part of an identity. So there's some things that are pretty obvious. Like if someone says, like, if I tell you guys I'm a Nazi, then you've seen enough of history. And even if you haven't seen history, you just have to look up. You can do a quick search online to look up what are the ideals of a Nazi, and racism will be part of that. And that's why so many people, like you said, there's only 30,000 people. I found that same statistic too, actually, recently, because jumping on this whole Charlottesville bandwagon, that's what stemmed a lot of this too. And people are saying that there's a big white nationalism or Nazism issue in the country. And to me, while I might not be in agreement with those things, and I think you should condemn them for all the obvious reasons to us, at least, and most people, it's you got to be realistic with the situation of why this is happening and what is a threat level. And if you overinflate it and just do this whole McCarthyism of pointing fingers at everyone that is maybe a white nationalist that or someone that's identifies with the alt-right or just even a conservative that's, oh, they're just doing it as an excuse for racism, and then they have actual issues that they want to bring up. And it even becomes, at that point, even if you're honestly looking into it, extremely hard to identify who are racist and who are non-racist unless they just do the opposite and like come out as like being a Nazi. Like, that is one of the only times.
I mean, yeah, this isn't too dissimilar from saying, okay, well, we know jihadists are bad, right? Even Muslim groups all over condemning jihadists. But then if we say, well, you know, we've got to look at all of them, and you start pointing them, that is anti-Muslim bigotry. You know, that's the problem. And you've got to be very nuanced about, there are plenty of very liberal Muslims that you don't know are Muslims, even, especially if they're not wearing Islamic clothing and it's not obvious. You don't know race. There's white, black Muslims, brown, all kinds. We have to have nuance there. And the left is right to be criticizing some of the right that will throw all Muslims in the same thing, saying it's taqiya, which is, you know, this they're allowed to lie to you. That's what it means. Oh, that they're allowed to lie in the religion. It's kind of like the opposite of the Catholic, where you don't deny God. You know, then it's a highest martyrdom. In Islam, there's this concept of taqiya, and then like every Muslim I've ever talked about is like, no, that's not really, we don't really buy into that. But the idea is you're allowed to lie if you're in danger. So if you're this hardcore right winger, you could say, well, just you can't trust any of them. And that's bad. This leads to real anti-Muslim bigotry, because it's okay to criticize jihadis. We need to criticize jihadis. We need to even criticize hardcore Islam, just like we criticize hardcore Christianity. But you got to nuance it in the same way. Now, the left has got to make this, when they're criticizing the right, they have to apply the same criticisms that they do when the hard right criticizes Islam. I think that's a fair analogy on this one.
I know you hit the nail right on the head there. I think it also comes down to, we feel the need as people to really hammer down what these categories are. As in, let's take racism, for example. You are a racist. People think there is a definite line between a racist and a not racist or a non-racist. Mm-hmm. And that's not true. You can be, well, I always like to say it's literally on a spectrum. You can be a little bit racist. You can be a little bit more racist. You can be overtly racist. You can be a KKK member. Like, that's just because you display some kind of, we'll say, dogmatic hate or dogmatic views towards something that may not be illogical towards someone's race or belief system, does that mean that you immediately fall under the most hardest extreme version of that label? And that's why I can't stand labels today, because to the point where they're almost useless anymore. If you say, well, you're a Christian, the hell does that even really mean? Because, yeah, you can say you worship Jesus, but beyond that, you can disagree on every single point beyond that. Even, and that's why I love like the idea of like the skeptics and the atheists so much, is that there's no such thing, we'll say, as a true blue atheist way. There is no way to do it. You can have liberal atheists, you can have a conservative atheist, you can have atheists who believe in aliens and magic or whatever it is. The only thing that connects any atheist is you don't believe in a god or gods. That's literally it. The rest is free game. And that's why I love that, because beyond that, there is no label. You can do whatever you want, and then you can speak for yourself at the end of the day. But we don't let other people have the same, I guess, chance that we give ourselves. Where if someone says they're a conservative, you me lump them in as anti-LGBT, anti-healthcare, anti-government, everything, might as well be a Ted Cruiser or a Trumpster. I mean,
yeah, I think we definitely use labels. I would like to see a changing of how we definitely use labels in the dialogue we engage in nowadays, because it seems that most people will, the problem I have with labels too is that people will do a clear defined definition of what you are that goes beyond what the label's defining. So once again, if you're looking at a Christian, I'd define a Christian as simply at the base level, the minimum you have to do to be a Christian is believe that Jesus exists as the Son of God and he died for your sins. Mm-hmm. I think we can all agree on that. But there's anything beyond that, you can have very conservative, like Westboro Christians, and then very liberal, like we accept all religions Christians. Mm-hmm. And those differences are quite drastic too. And even you'll have a lot of people today's being completely ignorant or dishonest of how they use their labels too. Same way we're using the Christian example. Again, I've heard people that say they don't even believe Jesus is the Son of God, but then they'll claim they're Christian. I'm like, by definition, you aren't, even if you do believe in a lot of the teachings of the Bible or Jesus' teachings. So I think you might be loosely bastardizing the term of what it means to be a Christian. So, and this applies to any other ideology too. And the second problem I have is how when people use labels, how like a conservative or a liberal, maybe if you can Google Wikipedia, you'll get a very basic definition of what they mean, but how most people use those words is on a political spectrum, and how most people use them will align topics that don't have anything in relation to one another. Like, you can assume that someone that's very conservative might be pro-life and pro-gun, but that's not always the case. But it's, those things don't have anything to do with one another. So do you guys notice this a lot too, where people use labels that either they're misusing the labels or they're trying to use it in an honest way, but just it doesn't, it still causes problems?
One of my favorite reactions, and I can't stand her, so let's put that out there first, was what happened to Tommy Lahren when she got deplatformed for going on, I think it was The View.
It was she was a reporter for The Blaze.
Well, yeah, but I think she went to The View
yeah.
and said that she was pro-choice. And she backed herself up saying, how can you be for a limited government and then have the government mandate what you do with your body? She got hit so hard for that. It was amazing how people just immediately turned on her. And those were her Republican base. That was it. Mm-hmm. So, but I always find it amazing with the abortion debate too, because it almost seems incredibly hypocritical, where you would think the conservative side would be the pro-choice side, where, limited government, don't let anyone touch my body, this is my own. Yet you have staunch conservatives and staunch Republicans who are saying, nope, we're going to force you by government and by law to not do this. So, I don't know. That's immediately the first example that comes to my mind when someone has this idea of what a label or someone who dons this label should be, and they're either not using it correctly or there's definite that cognitive dissonance where they're saying, wait a minute, something's not matching up here.
Yeah, I think Valerie Tirico and Karen Gartz, when we talked to her on the podcast, I think it was even years ago, like 1 or 2 years ago, mentioned that in the 70s, the Republicans and Democrats were pretty equally split on pro-choice. You know, they're on both sides. So that is one of the, it's probably, if we go back into recent history, one of the most polarizing topics that help push people apart. I think the other is like Newt Gingrich's switching with people don't have to live in Washington. So you don't have families, whole families living in Washington now to where, you know, Joe's a Democrat and I'm a Republican, our kids are friends. You know, and it's harder for me to like, you know, we don't agree or whatever, and this is fictitious, but we can talk. Maybe, you know, our wives are our friends or whatever, our partners, who knows? You know, yeah, we have to go to dinner. Maybe we can actually talk. Well, maybe, you know, well, he's an all right guy. I see the way he treats his kids. We share similar family values, even though no politics are the same. That's at least a starting piece of common ground.
It's the idea of the loyal opposition. That's where it all rested upon. And nowadays it's practically gone.
Yeah. I mean, right. I mean, the thought is we don't share anything, but many people do. And conservative and liberal, I mean, exist individually. You could have a conservative fiscal policy and a liberal social outlook. You could, I mean, I grew up in a family where we did not watch TV while we ate. That just, you know, but my friend Steve's, well, that's not how we do it here. Was that family any worse or better? No, but I mean, it's just a different outlook. And sometimes you need to be a conservative approach is a good approach. Sometimes a liberal approach is a good approach. And you've got to know when that is. And everybody does this. Even the most liberal person will take a conservative something or another. They just won't feel I'm a conservative. And that's the thing. That's where identity politics come in. It's not that you vote Republican. I am a Republican. Or I don't vote Democrat. I am a Democrat. So now, yeah, that's tribalistic. I don't root for the Green Bay Packers. I'm a Packer. And now you're really pushing that's going to unwind that tribalism to talk about it. You're going to need some friendship. And it's crazy that this can just break friendships, that people would believe, oh, my God, you did that. And then that's enough. Wow. I mean, you're making a lot of presuppositions about their values. And I don't think they're probably right.
Yeah, I think that the more someone seems to be proud of whatever label they have too, that they definitely get a lot more flack for it as well. And I think that labels are definitely useful when used correctly to just make a starting point of what it is. And once again, when you have people misusing or constantly changing the definition of these labels and what it means, or if you have major components of a community under a certain label that completely disagree on what they are while using the same term, that's where you get a lot of the confusion. Or especially like once again going back to the conservative liberal, where we can all have a general idea of what a liberal and conservative is, but once you get into the finer details, you're unsure. So, and the people that are really proud of their labels are the ones that most heavily identify with it. So that's why people wearing like a proud liberal or proud Republican hat just out in public, regardless of which side you're on, you can almost like hate that person. You're just gonna be like, oh, one of these guys. And you could be the most, like, I consider myself liberal, but whenever I see, like, a little bumper sticker on a car of proud liberal or proud liberal mom, dad, then I just kind of be like, oh, there are going to be some of that I know I'm going to, I can, within 5 minutes of conversation, I'll find some that strongly disagree with them on.
But the wince is okay. You know, I mean, if you see that in wince, but then remember, wow, there's an enormous variation within groups, then I would encourage people to do that, because it's amazing what you see. You know, someone calls themselves progressive, and that's the way they identify. And you talk to them, and you think, wow, I consider them like a classical liberal, maybe even slightly conservative. It's amazing what you get. But the way people define themselves, I think it's important to kind of really look past the label, in the same way that you got to look past the race. You know, like, oh, well, you know, that he's an Asian guy, he must be smart as hell. You know, seriously, I mean, you can do that. Or, you know, wow, the black person, he must have grown up in the inner city. I mean, if you're knee-jerk, is that's fine, but you're allowed to fight that. You know, it's a knee-jerk to see something go bump in the night and be scared, but then realize it's probably a branch bumping up against the house.
The big thing is we have to be aware of it. Mm-hmm. That's where it comes into play. I think that's where a lot of the disagreements come from as well, is people will refuse that they have these faults. Where, you know, let's look at racism, where if someone flinches at someone who is of another race, they will immediately deny it, because I'm not racist. I'm not, you know, just because I wince does not make me a racist. I just accept that we have flaws and that we're willing to work on them. That's all we expect. Right.
But then we're also given, even if it does happen, we don't give people enough space to admit it, because if you do, you're already slapped with that label.
Correct. And that's the biggest issues of labels today. And yeah. I think we have to get rid of, because you're still like one of the million qualities, does not mean you don every single quality of a label, or even don't give labels as much precedence as we do today. I do think labels are more, we'll say, of a byproduct of our pattern-seeking nature. We have to try to make sense of groups and subgroups and cultures and subcultures. But we have to ask the individual, what do they personally think as on an individual level? Because if we fail to do that, we're going to strawman them.
Try to think the label as the wrapping paper. It doesn't really matter. The present matters, right? Unless you're one of those people that saves the wrapping paper. But, you know, that's not that many people, right? But also changing labels, like what you said, the racism, like 2% racist versus 10. I mean, Brett Weinstein said it best, and he's the college professor that kind of got caught up in this, you know, this hubbub at Evergreen State, where, you know, he's vilified. But I mean, he's an anti-racist for sure, progressive Bernie voter, but an anti-racist for sure. And he was accused of being racist. And he said at our college, we had set the bar for racism so low that like the single tiniest microaggression that you'd never heard of was enough to get called a racist. And once you would admit it and apologize for that, again, you weren't saying you judge people by race, you were admitting to this low bar, you would be tarred with the meaning of the 100% highest bar, that I judge people by the color of their skin and think I know something or think my race is superior or something. That's wrong. We cannot let the definition of racism shapeshift. And I see that so often, and that polarizes and drives people, and that you can't let that kind of like slander and slur go wrong. It's the same thing. I mean, you could, like, jihadi could be the same way. You're calling all, you know, anyone's coming out of the mosque jihadi. I mean, this is also really bad.
Well, I think that's where people are even coming around saying you're a Nazi, where because they're not even treating the term Nazi as it was once used for. I would challenge you a little bit, where I'd say I think some transformation of language is okay, because that's progress. But beyond that, we have to be careful of not losing the meaning of the word too. But what I also think is very interesting is looking at a political spectrum. I remember in college, the College Republicans group at Whitewater, their biggest motto was, you're wrong about the right. And it was about this whole big rebranding thing, because millennials are changing the game now. Millennials are finally coming into play where their opinions actually do matter. They're starting to vote a lot more, and they're actually trying to get involved. They're not the little kids that these baby boomers once knew. Yeah. So the idea of what a real conservative is, and I see so many articles of, I'm a millennial conservative, but here's why. we have to be able to see what they believe on a point basis and not judge them by, well, like you said, the wrapper. And if we don't, or if we fail to do that, we're going to start categorizing people incorrectly. We're going to start calling people names that they shouldn't be called. And we're going to start creating enemies and start making lines that should never have been drawn in the first place.
Yeah, it's with a lot of these ideologies that people are gravitating to, it seems that when someone wants to align more strongly with it, it's that they either have so much pride for what it means to be, let's say, liberal conservative to them, or just to be in an extreme opposition that they hate the other, or they're so morally against the other side so much that they're going to more strongly identify with a group that they might not even otherwise care about. It's why I see so many posts on my Facebook where the people that will identify most as the term millennial are the people that are either using it the most politically, like, to represent like a political side, or in a very ironic sense, like, oh, look at me, am I the only conservative millennial that exists anymore, like that kind of talk. And so, well, no, of course you're not, but I think that more is a reflection of like what's going on in the current times, especially for the millennial generation. And with these, going back to tribalism, when it comes to these viewpoints that people want to bunch in these groups, is that they're doing it more for to preserve the values of that group, and not even giving the other side, even if they're correct on something, they don't want to give that other side any room, and they're not going to apologize because then they believe that the other side is going to take them over the second they give even any leg room, even if they, like, I think we can all agree we'd want that. And I think any honest person would agree on that too. But especially when it comes to the left versus the right, you never see the other side say, oh yeah, I guess that's a good point. You never see that, because the second you do that, then they'll trample over you.
You're admitting to yourself that, okay, I'm not 100% moral. Maybe if I have to cede that 5%, now I'm only 95% moral. I don't like that feeling, right? But the other part is like a traitor, right? I mean, what if somebody said, yeah, I voted for Trump. I screwed up. You know, that was dumb. I'm going to come back. And you might get a group of people that said, we don't want you. You know, like, you should have known. How could you? There must be something wrong with you. It seems like, you know, back and forth, you could get a traitorous idea. You know, I saw it, maybe it was emotions, but if you voted for X, you can just go ahead and unfriend me. I mean, you saw some of that. Yeah. That means we don't even want you back if you regretted it. Wow. You know, that might be another reason you don't want to concede any points, because if you do, you may lose your in-group. And now you might be excommunicated from both groups. Maybe like Tommy Lahren, you know, I bet she feels, you know, excommunicated from both. Now, I'm sure there's others. There's tons of nuance in there. There's people that still very much like Tommy Lahren, but maybe they can't say it.
Yeah. Well, and I'm thinking, look at how, and maybe you guys can help me, look at how, like, conservatives will attack rhinos, you know, and I don't know.
A Republican in name only.
Thank you. Specifically because of that, you're not a Republican unless you do this, or unless you vote this way. And they will immediately just start eating their own, just because they want to stick to this very dogmatic view of life. They will not allow nuance into it. But I can also say that's the exact same thing that's happening on the left too, where you have people who are saying, well, if you were a true liberal, you would have voted for Bernie Sanders. You're not a liberal if you voted for Hillary Clinton. So, and heck, it was that mentality that a lot of people ended up voting for Trump anyway. So, I don't know if that's, I mean, yes, it's obviously a bad thing, but I don't know how bad that mentality actually is. I understand the idea of, I don't care what side you're on, I'm going to call BS on you. You know, even if you're a liberal, I can't stand when someone who is a liberal will start mouthing off BS. I will immediately say you are wrong, even if I agree with you on other points. But at the same time, you're alienating more people than you're actually uniting. So I don't know which is the best way to handle something like that.
And it's hard. I think one of the things maybe we can do is, instead of criticizing liberalism or conservatism or the Republican Party or the Democrats or Joe, right? Say, I disagree with you, Joe. Or say, you know what? Can we unpack the notion of X? Look at it from the idea. Are we sure we agree with the idea of? Now, maybe that's it's the best thing I can do to have a present without the label, you know, then maybe we can get at it. And I think a lot of times we have to be nice. We came up with the Skeptic's Pledge. And especially with our recent, our upcoming Myth Information Conference, this is what we want, because we really feel like, based on our speakers, we're going to have a pretty diverse audience as far as worldview. So some of the things, and I'll read a couple, allow others to speak their minds, whether I agree with them or not. Many times we don't want to hear all that argument. Having people restate their argument and make them, okay, if I understand you, Joe, you believe X, Y, Z, and with these caveats, am I correct? And you say, yeah, basically. Now I'm ready to make a counter argument. But if he says, no, you're kind of missing the point, Brian. I have to be able to spit it back to where Joe, or else I can't agree with them effectively. Other, just engage in conversation with those of differing opinion. I mean, don't try not to, especially at the Myth Information Conference. Get out of your bubble. You're going to learn something, and you'll probably like these people. And it's also okay to say, wow, I really don't agree with you on much of anything, but you seem like a nice person. That's okay too. So we don't want to say what, you know, not to do as much as what we ought to do. You know, be fair and prudent in making judgments. You know, like, really try to question yourself, value evidence over dogma, and, you know, listen before replying. You know, there's a whole, you can check it out, the Skeptic's Pledge on Mythicist Milwaukee on Twitter. Let us know if you like it. We think it's a good thing, but if you keep some of those principles, I think we can dissect some of these things. I think but you have to try. Like, if you go in like hog wild, you're probably gonna hit somebody in the nose.
Well, I think that's the thing, is it's a lot easier said than done. I mean, I'm one of the most patient guys I would ever know, but even I have my limits of when someone's talking to me. It's very hard to talk to someone who's just not on the same page as you.
Well, give me an example.
Well, let's take a look at, you know, let's make it very easy. As an atheist and a Christian, right?
Mm-hmm.
When an atheist and Christian typically find disagreements, it's basically because they're coming from two completely different mindsets. And neither one is willing to admit that they're just coming from a different mindset, or they're just not even agreeing that they're on the same page. Those immediately judge them for being stupid or misguided on both sides. So I think what you have to do is you have to really buckle down and try to find what makes them and see where you can find the connection. Like you were saying, don't assume what they believe, but actually ask them, am I with X, Y, and Z?
Yeah, but I think you're actually pretty good at it, Joe. I mean, we spent half the Reason Rally going around doing just that, and you seem to have fun with it.
Well, I do, but I'm saying, even as a patient person, I still have my limits, and I still struggle with it like everyone else. No one's immune from that. That's what I'm trying to
do. Right, and what I'm saying, too, and not every day is the MythCon, right? I don't want people like to do this every day. But make a point to sometimes do it. It's kind of like flossing your teeth, right? Who flosses their teeth every day, right? It's my hygienist is going to kick my ass. But, you know, just try to do it. You know, maybe it's like going to the gym. We're going to make an effort.
Yeah, and that's also why, we'll say from a more nuanced topic, why this is going to sound weird, I am fascinated with abortion. or with the abortion debate.
LOL.
There's a context quote for you. No, it's because specifically both sides are so polarized on it, they literally think the other side is the ultimate evil in this case. Where you have the pro-life side who thinks the pro-choice side is doing nothing but murder babies in the millions. And it's hard for them to even get around that for some people. And then you have people on the pro-choice side who are only saying they're just against women. They hate
Or your women are second class citizens, correct. You know, and they're only equal if they're not pregnant, and now they're correct. Subordinate.
And it's amazing to me where I see people on both sides who are just failing to realize they're both good people, but they just happen to disagree or they find different values somewhere, but they will refuse to acknowledge that they're a good person because of this. And it leaves someone on the outside just scratching their head. Even if they know them, they'll immediately start judging them afterwards, or they'll start judging me in the middle of the conversation saying, I now see you differently because of this one opinion you have, even though they know them on a different spectrum or a different level or a different topics.
Right. And that's why I would encourage people, rather than to think, why am I friends with this person? As, wow, this is a good person that actually thinks completely different than me.
Correct.
Maybe there is something, even if I find that position a bit repulsive, maybe there is something to it, that there is some morality there.
And I think that's where I find some fascination with it too, where I always love, especially when someone disagrees with me, I want to know where they're coming from, because I know where I'm coming from. It's easy for me. I know where people who understand me, I know where they're coming from too, because it makes sense to me already. I want to know who someone who completely comes out of left field and they're just not even in the same book, you know, as I am. How did you come to this point? Is it actually rational? How far can I take it without just dismissing you as crazy? Because a lot of these people, well, they will be good-hearted people, but they'll say that their point is right because it was either some emotional thing, it was a cultural thing, a societal thing, and they actually didn't think it through, or B, they actually have interesting evidence that to them just overwhelmed them to that belief. But from the opposing side, we just never care to look at it that way. We just see them as wrong.
Yeah, it can be quite mentally exhausting just trying to approach these topics with people. And that's why I think that if someone's honestly trying to pursue the title of being like the skeptic, not just religion here, but just with anything, I think it can be a very noble thing to pursue when done correctly. Because it's the thing I started noticing too when I started looking into these topics more is how, especially, it's incredibly hard to be honest about these topics and know enough to say to be correct on them. I'm sure that if you ask any, like every person you knew, no matter how much you respected them, like your heroes, you could find a way to prove them to be a piece of shit. And so I had noticed that too with people I really respected were on one topic, they'd be just spot on. And then another topic, I'm like, how did you get to this conclusion? There has to be some way. Like, I already know you, so I know I respect you. Mm-hmm. Like, there has to be a way you got here. And sometimes just having those conversations, you just really get into the meanings. Like, it's hard to dig through those thoughts and just to learn how they got to that point. It's incredibly time-consuming and mentally exhausting.
Yeah, it really depends. There's morality on both sides. I mean, with the abortion argument, it's the moral thing is not to murder. And that's the idea. They're assuming that, you know, a fertilized egg is a life. Now you have the morality point there. Same way that women are not autonomous. That if you're pregnant now, you are beholden to that you become less autonomous. Then the moral point is equality of the sexes. Both of these are moral positions. It's just in the abortion date, they are in opposition because many of the people, the pro-life, will say, well, we're for equality too. A pregnant woman doesn't lose. And that's the idea. There probably is some morality behind the other person's position. I mean, if the capitalist is versus communist, I mean, there's morality behind both of these positions. And I think that's where you have to understand that they are coming from and maybe try to indicate like communism would be better for everyone. Well, somebody could say capitalism is better. Well, here's why. But if you could maybe drill down to the fact that you really are both trying to raise the standard of people for the world, maybe that's a point of common ground that can allow this discussion to like unwind a little bit or at least walk down the path a little bit before you part ways. You know, trying to find some common ground. When Joe and I bring this up all the time, we're arguing with a whole bunch of religious, but then from the hardcore to the medium core and light. And once the girl in the middle of a thing, you know, thinking we were, like some sort of, I don't know, going to hell or something or some sort of immoral, she goes, well, I believe in separation of church and state. And we said, I said, argument over. I go, that's enough common ground for us. I go, I don't need to argue with anymore. We can agree. And she was a bit shocked. I think she expected me to keep on fighting her. And I said, no, that's fine. You can you just carry on. I go, can we go get a beer now? And she just looks at me and was stunned that okay, that's good. And like her friend even looked at me and said, wow, you're making some really good arguments. I kind of feel weird right now. And I'm like, look, I don't want to wreck your faith, dude. I mean, that was the point. I mean, the point wasn't to eviscerate. The point was, I think, to find common ground or understand each other. At least that's what we were attempting to go into the discussion with. In that case, it worked. And in other cases, it didn't.
Correct. And even with those cases, too, from the most closed-minded protesters that I talked to there, I could still tell that they were coming from a moral point. Which I could understand, like, I get why you're saying the things you're saying, where if you don't understand where I'm coming from, that's fine. But I at least can say, okay, you're not like this total heartless person. You actually do mean what you say. And I don't think people actually give people credit for that. It's almost like that phrase where you can't be this stupid. You can't be this stupid. You have to be diabolical in some way because I know you can't be this dumb. Well, in some ways, yeah, we are. We do have these irrational beliefs that we hold on to because we never think about them before. And sometimes it just takes someone just to talk to us about it.
But they could be rational, but for a different setup, right? I mean, in baseball, you line the defense up differently for right and left-handers, mm-hmm. right? So, I mean, which one's right? Do I keep my second baseman right behind there, or do I move him over? Well, they're both right. It depends on the situation. So I think, you know, if we look at it that way, you can have both positions be moral. If you can identify with the moral part of the other side and say, okay, I get that you're coming from that, but I think I think what you're doing might actually be counterproductive to the moral position that you really want. Maybe that's a better way than, dude, are you even thinking this through? Because that suggests you're dumb. You haven't thought about it. There's a right and wrong. When there is both. Like, should I forgive or do I need to disconnect? Mm-hmm. Both are right. Like, sometimes I might need to disconnect from that person completely. But other times, maybe the right thing to do is forgive.
Yeah, I definitely look at the moral intent of someone whenever we engage in discussion like this, too, because you can make up any sorts of examples about how you, even if you don't agree with the person, if you see them going against it, like I think I've heard the example before with abortion, how that if you are like the most pro-life you can be, but then you get like a girl pregnant on accident, then you're willing to kill that baby. Like what? Even though maybe someone that's has opinion that's pro-choice, that I think it's just not even like a fetus. I think you're just killing cells. That might not be offensive to them, but to that person, what the other pro-lifer just did might be extremely offensive because they know how much moral goodness that they just went against their own moral beliefs on. Mm-hmm. And it's also how I respond to people too that I might be debating with, is that someone that's completely dishonest and is being extremely hypocritical or constantly changing the argument just to win, I might be more inclined to call the person a piece of shit. But someone that is getting super flustered, that might at face value appear to be saying the exact same things, but just might be like has an honest intent. And like, I don't care if someone gets angry during a debate, if it means a lot to them, I'd rather not. But if they're being honest with their intent and they're genuinely striving to do moral goodness, then I won't nearly be as offended of what they're saying.
Right. The other thing is that there may be something that they've experienced that makes their position unique. So rather than just lumping them in with the whole, you know, for example, sometimes, like in our particular case, we have people that are fired up to come to the MythCon, and then there's some people that don't like our speaker lineup. And I've fielded a whole bunch of emails of saying, oh my God, you guys have done the best. I can't wait to come. And then others that have criticized our choices. And in one case, what I'm really trying to apply our pledge, and one of them was a man, a doctor from Spain, and he was, you know, I think, wow, all the way across the world, he's probably not going to come, but he wants to make his opinion heard. So he wrote a long letter, and my first response back wasn't to really do anything other than to clarify what he said. And I said, if I'm understanding you right, X, Y, and Z, and I'm like, if I'm wrong, please add the required nuance. And then I kind of gave a different example of a few things and also applauded him for, you know, making a very, I thought, thoughtful dissent and in a way, and it was polite. And I thought, this is an answer. I'm an email. I'll answer. If somebody says, F you, I don't like your speakers, that's not going to get a response, you know? I won't go into all of it, but when he started the letter, he goes, well, let me tell you, I'm in archaeology. The first assignment that I ever did, we went and dug up mass grave from the Spanish Civil War in 1936. And as he described that, it was clear that this was going to relate to the rest of it. So just that being able to engage and get that personal piece, this is probably going to affect him in a unique way that I wouldn't have realized if I don't engage. And I think that's there's probably a ton of that. We're all wild individuals or wildly different individuals. So there probably are unique things of, man, that's why that I don't like that. And somebody says, wow, man, I don't like you too. What do you mean you don't like you too? Oh, well, you should have heard what happened the last time you two, you know, they, you know, you just don't like that song anymore because something bad happened to you. Makes sense. But you can't say, oh, wow, you're just not a rock lover. And I think that really investigating, you know, why is that? Sometimes it will work if people are polite. If the person's just simply not willing to engage, you probably have to disengage. But I would encourage people to try to take some extra time because there's some really good stuff out there. And I think there's morality to be found on the other side. And maybe you can apply that in your own way. And you probably do. I mean, a conservative person doesn't always make conservative decisions. Sometimes conservative people are like, should we do this? Should we all? Yeah, screw it. You know, that's not a conservative position. That's a liberal. Like, yeah, let's explore. Let's, sure. You know, that everyone does this. And liberal people all the time are, look, you got to be home on time. You know, my kids are got a curfew. This is the way it is. That's a very conservative position. That house, they've always voted Democrat. I think if we look at it like that, that helps.
Yeah, people aren't black and white. So it's whenever I look in value of someone that I hold in high regard, it usually means that they have done one area that I have a lot of respect for that they've approached. One of my favorite examples is with Isaac Newton, the father of physics, and how I didn't know this until recently, and whether it's true or not, I don't know, but let's assume it is, that we know his achievements to science, and that's why he's held as one of the most brilliant people, or one of the most brilliant men of all time. And he spent the majority of his time looking at all these preposterous Illuminati-level Christian mythos that even most Christians nowadays would scoff at anyone spending their time on. Obviously, if that's the only thing he did, he would be lost into the canals of history. But since he did this one thing so well, a lot of us have respect for him and continue to teach about him. So I apply that same logic to a lot of people I know too, where I've had people that have said like the most dumbass arguments on one topic, but then I remember how they spoke so well and so innovative on another topic that I'm like, okay, maybe I'll be much more skeptical whenever they talk about this other topic. But when they talk about the topic that I know that is their forte, I have much less of a level of skepticism applied to them.
I remember like a meme back in the 2016 election, and that just reminds me of, well, we now know there's always multiple sides of people. You can be Ben Carson, the doctor, or Ben Carson, the presidential candidate. I mean, because for all you know, they could be an expert in something that does not mean they're an expert in everything right. else. So, and I completely
right. Brain surgeons are not dumb. Right. They just know brain surgery. The only thing you really know is they know brain surgery really well.
Correct.
They might know history. They might not.
Correct. Hashtag grain silos. But I guess let me ask you guys a question too. So we've been talking about dogmatism in a very negative way. I mean, hence probably because we're all skeptics and we see the damage that dogmatism does. What's the good use for dogmatism? Is there a good use for dogmatism, and where would you apply it?
Well, I think that there has to be some. You can't have zero. I think you're looking for minimum dogmatism. I mean, there's certain basic agreements that I think we have to have, you know, that are the base of society, you know, that the certain, you know, that we're both human, that we're both going to use logic to do this discussion. We agree on certain principles.
I would go even more basal than that. I would say even just a human's right to life is a dogmatic position. That's a positive dogmatic position, because at the end of the day, we have known that life is precious, and we, even if there is maybe context around that, I think the vast majority of humans would say humans have a right to at least some type of life.
Right? Yeah, you're gonna the at some point you will have to have a few, but you can't have you can't have a ton. I mean, science in some ways, the scientific method is rigorous. You know, there are certain things that you do and there's certain things that you can't. And we kind of all agree that that's the best way to get at these things, that there's a certain dogma there. Someone said, well, could there be some other method? Well, maybe, but not that we know of. So it seems like they're, you know, dogma and following the science, the rigor, I guess. You know, there's certain things that it seems like you can't have any, or else now you're in a fully postmodern world where you can, everything can be anything.
Well, and I guess that leads
dogmatism on meaning, maybe.
Yeah, well, that leads to a good question too. Would you guys say that being dogmatic towards, we'll say, evidence and reason is actually dogmatism?
I wouldn't say that would be dogmatism.
You would not?
No.
Okay.
And the reason is because when you look at what the definition of dogmatism is, and I'm not sure if this is the exact definition, but it's following things in the exact opposite way from an unreasonable standpoint. So when people have like a tribal attitude, let's just say tribal here towards science, because I have heard people say that, you're dogmatic for science. I look at something that's been proved over and over again, and so you can, I'm sure, find certain pockets in the scientific community where maybe the methodology of the research can be a question. I think that's just fine. But for no one's going to be questioning the theory of gravity anytime soon. So when you apply those sets of logic, it helps bring progress forward. So if you look at the world from a postmodernistic standpoint, you will never make any progress, which is very ironic, considered a lot of postmoderns are progressives, but who am I to judge? So
I get it. I get the joke.
I think that having a certain level of dogmatism, tribalism,
but maybe it's fundamentalism that we're talking about, because like,
sure,
you're fundamentalist about the scientific, you know, method. You know, you could be a free speech fundamentalist. Mm-hmm. People will say that too. So maybe it's not dogma that I was looking for, but fundamentalism. But you would want to limit, like, generally, like, what are the religions that we, but what religious practices we oppose the most? It's fundamentalism. Like, if you have the moderate Christian, the very, you know, moderate people, we have a lot less disagreements. I'm content to leave those people alone.
Yeah. And well, the real only reason why I even bring it up is because when you have people who disagree with a lot of skeptics, we'll even take religious people for an example. Well, they'll try to say that, yeah, I mean, dogmatic towards science is definitely one of them, but I would even say dogmatic towards, like, materialistic observations. We have to, like, see it happen, or we have to see the data before we can have an opinion towards it. Where they'll say that's actually a bad dogmatic belief. Sometimes you just have to take things by chance. So, and that's why I'm curious why we would consider it. Because I agree with you, Ken. I don't think that's dogmatism. I believe leaning towards evidence is the exact opposite. But I found it very interesting when I was called dogmatic because of that. So yeah, that's why
it gets
that
weird. I mean, you can have those, but it seems like pure fundamentalism probably won't ever work on anything. I mean, Star Trek, I feel like I got a lot of morality from Star Trek Next Generation. You know, the prime directive is the thing you just can't screw up, yeah, right? That you can interfere with another culture's development until they get to warp speed. I mean, that you would completely impact them in this negative way. But then what's happening? And then you see sometimes, well, is it one circumstance, is this moral to do? Is sometimes the good of the few outweigh the good of the many, or vice versa? It's interesting. And I don't think you can be fundamentalist about anything, because at times it will appear cold. And I think that, you know, there's something to that. And so the person on the other side of that argument, when you say, well, this, I mean, maybe that's the thing. Am I being cold? Is the right of the individual trump the right of the many? Sometimes it does, but probably not that often, but sometimes. And in weighing those, I don't know. I mean, this gets into philosophy, and I'm not smart enough to deal with this, but you gotta sometimes wonder. It's okay to think I might be wrong, and it's okay to think I can be wrong and moral, and that you could hopefully expect that other people to also perceive you as that way too.
Yeah, trying to reflect upon what you're saying now too. I definitely agree that it's really hard. I think it's trying to find the base levels of what we can all agree upon, and that's where arguments happen. I think that's what arguments are so useful for, and how I've been starting to see a shift, at least in the skeptic community, about how a lot of arguments that will happen will be more along the lines of, let's not win quote, like air quotes, win these debates. Let's just try to understand what we're disagreeing upon. And I think a lot of people get intimidated by this, too. I find certain people that are more aggressive, even if they don't intend to be, with debating that. They'll say something like, well, see, here's the thing that you're just asking about. Well, here's the statistic. This is what it says. And am I right? I'm like, in my mind, I'm thinking, like, do I trust this person that what they're saying is correct? Are they skewing it? If I say, then, yes, I agree with them, are they going to say, well, you're just wrong, like, right after, and then this debate is over? Or are they going to have that kind of attitude? Like, and it really comes down to this trust and honesty with debating. And so, and that applies to more the macro level when people will form these groups, these fundamental groups too. And I think that the fundamental groups will agree on things that have been established. Like to me, something that's been established is the occurrence of climate change. You can debate the rate of climate change, but I think that the people I don't have any respect for, people are saying that it just is not happening at all. But the people that say like, I agree with climate change, but I'm against the alarmists, I'll be much more in sympathy with them.
Right. But you would want to ask them, too, why they think that. I mean, I've heard it's a Chinese hoax. I've seen this graph disproves it, right? Okay, one graph, really. Okay. Sometimes then you're thinking, well, we can't do this. I mean, this is just, you know, the globalists trying to give China the advantage. We're giving away everything. But if you can empathize with that, and there is a good point that, yes, we got to be worried about climate change, but we can't sacrifice the American economy in, you know, that effort to get there. You just can't do it. You can't, you know, cut off your nose to spite your face or something like that. So if you can identify the moral point that they're coming from, like dig deeper, try to find that. I mean, it's possible that they're just way out there and you can't engage. But if you try, you might be able to dig it up, you know, because there's probably something. Again, they're probably not 100% wrong. A lot of people are 98-99% wrong. If you can find that tiny bit of common ground, you might be able to move, and you might be able to refine your own position better because maybe yours wasn't totally right.
Well, and I think a lot of it comes down to, we'll say, where people put their standards on whether or not we should discuss these things. Where if you have a, specifically with climate change, you have hard science-minded people, they're going to say, there's no discussion to have. You're just wrong, and that's it. Where, and then even when someone says, well, let's talk to them and see where they're coming from, that hard science-minded person will now condemn the person trying to talk to them because they would say something along the lines of, why are you giving them credence? Why are you giving them a platform to talk? There's no discussion to be had. And that's with a lot of topics we see today where you'll have, like, for example, race. Is there an issue with racism? Some people just don't even want to talk about it at all, and some people will say, no, let's have the discussion about it. Or even the idea of white nationalism. Like, take our conference, for example. There have been numerous people saying just because of our speaker lineup, they've written and complained about our conference just because they don't want these people to speak at all because they think there's no conversation to even be had there, where some of us may say, no, there is. Let him get his butt beat if that's the way it's going to go down. Well, let's have the conversation at all to at least hear the guy out.
Yeah, so there's a couple things going on. Like, one, the white nationalist slur is being thrown around, like, far too often. Because, I mean, would we platform a white nationalist? No, we wouldn't do it. But there are some people that are perceived on the right and the left. And the thing is, wow, it seems there are people out there that think anyone to the right of Lenin is a white nationalist, and it's just kind of crazy. And like, no, we wouldn't do this. We vet our speakers. We know what we're doing. But will we put somebody who's pro social justice up against a person who's anti social justice? Yes, and that's what we're doing, because that is a good conversation. It'll be interesting to see what comes out. Will people flip? And you know, will Thomas Smith and Sargon of Akkad flip each other? Will they flip anyone in the audience? Probably not. Will they help create some nuance in between some of those other views? Yes, I hope so. I really do. And that you can reach across and talk to somebody who calls themselves, I'm a proud SJW. Oh my God, I'm totally not. You know, I anti-SJW. Man, I would never call myself a feminist. But realize, wow, you're an all right person. You know, I wouldn't have thought. I thought you were on my side. Well, that's the person you want to talk. Like, realize that these people are not that far apart. Like, and that there's certain nuances that you could get there, and that people understand the other side, you can have diplomats. We don't have any diplomats on the top level. It seems like everyone's yelling, you know, and that's like us and them rather than just ideas, and they mix. I mean, so often you find people hold ideas that you didn't expect.
However, I will come in and say I understand that's also within reason. I mean, there are some things where dialogue just, there's no point to having dialogue.
Yeah.
Like you wouldn't have a dialogue, you know, with David Duke on one side and NAACP on the other side. Like, there's no point to that conversation.
Sure. Yeah, the political fringes, I'm convinced they can't be part of the political discussion. Correct. That those people need de-radicalization. Just like the jihadi, right? Are you going to let him be part of the discussion? No, we can't. But some, or maybe somebody's ready to be jihadi. But like, you've got to de-radicalize them. You can't just kill these people. Right, but go on. I'm sorry to cut you off.
No, that's literally my point is that, and I think that's where a lot of these people who complain about the MythCon is they're drawing that line a lot sooner than we are. We're even saying things such as talking about social justice. That's not a conversation we have. There is social justice and then those who are wrong.
Right.
But
it's weird. I mean, this has become the moral thing. So you think an atheist conference, like who's most likely to protest this? You would think the religious, right? No, not in this case. In this case, since we're talking about social justice in addition to religion, it's those that are such strong advocates for social justice that if you would platform somebody that disagrees with that, you almost have, it's almost like the fundamentalist Christians say, how dare you have platform somebody that's going to say there's no God? You're just going to disperse morality. These people are going to go out and do things. You're creating harm. I ought to stop you or deplatform you. And in this case, that moral feeling, I think, is as intense as the fundamentalist that says, don't you dare. And that's what we're facing. Now, a lot of people want this debate. A lot of people want this discussion. It needs to happen. But that's why we did the Skeptic Speech Pledge to say, look, come. You know, if you're anywhere in this center where you feel like, yes, somebody could be moral on the other side, you know, but I don't agree with them, yeah, come. If you're on the absolute fringes, no, you're probably not going to have a good time.
Well, and I think even a better example than what we have at our conference, even more magnified, was when Milo Yiannopoulos was a real thing. I mean, he's not anymore, but back when like Bill Maher let him on his show, everyone chastised Bill Maher for even bringing him on. I mean, how dare you bring this guy on at all? And that caused a real debate. You know, do we have a conversation with someone who is saying incredibly absurd things? Do we even let him like speak out so I can understand him better? Or do we just shut him out and say, no, you're crazy, you're so irrational, I'm not even gonna even let you speak to people because it's dangerous, right? That's the idea, that what he said was dangerous. So I don't know where that fine line is personally. I keep going back and forth where, yes, I would want to say, at the same time, even though I know I want to give someone the free speech, where I want to give someone a platform to hear themselves out from like a science perspective. If they take a hard anti-science, like, for example, on vaccines, I don't want them to have a platform because we know already that they're wrong based on evidence and that they're being dogmatic. So that's where it's constantly in conflict, is where do you draw that line?
Right. Well, like, it depends on what you're trying to do. If you had a whole group of anti-vaxxers and you wanted to help educate them, maybe you're probably going to have to be able to understand that argument. So I mean, that's okay to talk to them, but in some ways you really have to look at what you're trying to do. And right now what we're trying to do is get people to be less rigid in their thinking, to question themselves, maybe to turn inward to the center a little bit. So yeah, no, you don't want to platform the extremes in that case.
Because I even remember very recently that, who was it? I think it was Vice that did a quick interview with a neo-Nazi, straight up mm-hmm. skinhead neo-Nazi. And it was an African-American leading the interview with the neo-Nazi. And it was, well, to me, at least, a very interesting interview. The problem is it went nowhere because the guy was insane. He literally tried saying, you know, this is why whites are better than everyone else to a black person. But And people, and again, Vice got chastised saying, why did you even have a segment about this? There's no conversation to be had. Look what Eddie even said. All you did was just give him a platform to talk to more people about his disgusting beliefs. But then from a selfish point of view, I do want to know where he's coming from. So it's almost like a weird trade-off where it's like, yes, I just gave him a platform, but at the same time, now we know a little bit about where they're coming from to hopefully de-radicalize them. And I would like to think that the best way to do it is to let them talk more, to create more dialogue. I'm still under the idea that more discussion will create more peace and more unity at the end of the day if it's done civilly.
Yeah.
Without civil discussion, you're going to create more subgroups, more echo chambers, and you're going to have the divided country we have now today.
Right. And that's the thing. You're allowed to entertain an idea without embracing it. I mean, that is something we can do. I can entertain creationism. Just for a second, let's put it through. Let's run the test. That's fine. That doesn't mean I have to believe it. So if you can proceed in that way, you know, as far as de-radicalization goes, I mean, I'd love to talk to Majid Nawaz and the Quilliam Institute, because that's what they do. And I'm not sure how they do it. I bet that would be fascinating.
Correct. But it's almost like a weird selfish point of view, though. It's like, yes, I want to understand where you're coming from, but at the same time, you're not going to get anything from me, though, if that makes sense. If you're the radicalized person, at least.
Right. Right. And yeah, and a radical person talking to the centrist to debate and try to come to policy doesn't make sense. But as far as a de-radicalization discussion, I think that's fine. But, it's okay for like, Ben Shapiro debated Cenk Gungar. Right, from the Young Turks. That was awesome. You know, political opposite positions, but, you know, move. And do some of them have good points on both sides? Yes. Now, it's a where do you determine? Is it 98% Ben and 2% Cenk or the other way around? But that we can work out. But you can't farm David Duke and a Black Panther. You can't.
Correct.
It doesn't make sense.
Yeah, when it comes to determining these things, I think it's, and this is where, getting back to your thin line here, and where people's fear comes from is, what if you had some like Richard Spencer, someone that, to me, when I first heard about the man, I heard he's racist. I listened to his video directly about the rally he did, and I remember him saying something loosely on the lines of like, white racists we've been destined to be like the greatest race. And so to me, that by definition is racism. Yeah. So I know that even if he sounds very classy, very charismatic, that the core points he's making on the topics of race, I will never agree with. And so we get into this whole kerfuffle about people saying, like, should we punch him? Should we let him speak? I know that YouTuber Roaming Millennial, she talked with him, too, and I guess they had a very productive discussion.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
I don't know how long ago it was, but I didn't even get a chance to watch it all. I got distracted. I'll have to go back. But anyway, it's like people like that, what do you do? It's like what I like to imagine in a perfect world is that for every person that's a charismatic speaker that brings up what could very well be a horrible idea, but can portray it in such a brilliant way, what if that idea spreads? And then that's where a lot of people's fear comes up of why they want to deplatform someone like Milo. He's very charismatic and likable, politics aside. And so people don't want someone like that to speak because they'll think that, well, the people that are listening to him, especially if they haven't really thought about the arguments that much, they're going to start getting this legion of followers now. And while they might not be as obviously bad as the jihadists or the crazy neo-Nazi you're describing, Joe, it's something that can be very intimidating to people, and that's where that thin line becomes of, do we let him speak and risk the chance that what if a bunch of people follow him and that everyone that's debating him don't come up with good arguments, even though you have a feeling that's bad, or do you let him speak? And in the best case scenario, someone will, this first time he speaks publicly and he goes mainstream, you'll have another equally charismatic speaker against him that'll deconstruct all of his bad ideologies, and then you won't be hearing him in the news anymore because it'll be not an issue anymore.
Well, and that's also where I do swing more towards the don't let them speak route in times like this as well, because from a very cynical perspective, the idea of letting people speak and letting rational dialogue come is based on the assumption of you're dealing with rational people. And the vast majority of people are not rational. So when you have someone like Miley Yiannopoulos or Richard Spencer speak, I immediately think of, why the heck do I know the name Richard Spencer? I shouldn't even know that guy exists because his ideas are so abhorrent. Yet, people are talking to him. And yet, he's still gaining some type of following because people are talking to him. I take the idea of Trump again for an example, where his ideas on TV were absolutely terrible. But because he was given so much airtime, the irrational people fell in love with him because he was a very charismatic speaker. They didn't have anything to prove him wrong, so they voted for him. Should we then... I understand the idea of having rational dialogue, and I think, Brian, you said it too. We have to have it within reason, if I remember that
correctly. Well, it has to be a set with the values that you're promoting. So MM would not platform a white nationalist or someone known to be racist. Now, that doesn't mean that, like, inside the Quilliam Foundation, that when you're doing de-radicalization, might be different, mm-hmm. right? So I'm not an expert at that, so I don't know what I'm doing there. But I guess I feel that more people are... They're rational in a way because morality it plays tricks on rationality, right? I mean, you're the Christian and you're trying to hold the belief that, you know, this God is completely just and you have a binary heaven and hell, but he's all loving, right? These two things, that's going to be pretty hard rationally to pull through, but morally, it's fine. And I think that's the thing. We are rational and moral. So, yes, we are rational, but many times the morals get in the way. So I think that people can move. And I don't know. YouTube has – you get a huge platform on YouTube, right? You can reach so many more people than you could ever come to a conference, right? I mean, you just – for traveling and, you know, these people have worldwide audiences. They've already got a huge platform in some ways. What I think is – you know, if you're what MM's trying to do is pull it in more centrist, but when you meet somebody, it's not so much the speakers that you want to agree, but their listeners. Like, can you talk to them? Right? It's going to be, you know, you don't want a bunch of white nationalists there, right? But the people that are coming to MM are liberals, libertarians, you know, left progressives, and, you know, some center right conservatives. I mean, that's who's going to come. But can the progressives talk to the conservatives? That's what I do believe that there can be some rational discourse there. Maybe even if it's just a little, we don't have to walk 100 yards, just 10. But that's better than zero. And it's certainly better than going negative 10 yards the other way and start thinking anyone who identifies as burgers are aggressive, I don't like her. Anyone that says they're conservative, screw them. That's where I think we can get at, because you don't have to like the speakers, but the audience, you know, think, well, maybe these guys are just lawyers. I mean, think about what happens in a courtroom. These lawyers take an extreme position on both sides, right? And the judge is supposed to be that, the audience, the jury are those people, you know, that can. So don't worry about the attorneys, you know, worry about getting at the truth.
Correct. And that's why whenever I talk politics, I try my best not to talk about the politicians. I always talk about the political followers. I don't necessarily care as much about what Trump thinks, but what his supporters think, because at the end of the day, those are the ones who are voting. Those are the ones who are buying into it, and I care more about where they're coming from, because I think they're more likely to change than having Trump change, if that makes sense. And I think you're going to agree with me here too, Brian, where we have to be very careful of where we draw the line of, we can't have a discussion here, where it's the idea of that fundamentalist free speech idea comes from, where at the end of the day, I don't want to go into a slippery slope. I don't want someone calling me out and silencing me because they think what I'm saying is dangerous. So we need to let free speech happen for all. But at the same time, we do see instances where maybe people shouldn't have platforms. And I'm not entirely sure. At the end of the day, we shouldn't force people off of platforms,
right?
But we're not entitled to give them platforms.
That's absolutely true. So, that's absolutely true.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like Milo, like Berkeley giving a platform to Milo. Well, no, he doesn't deserve a platform, and definitely doesn't deserve it. The thing is, the college Republicans of Berkeley are the ones who invited him.
Correct. And I think that's where it comes down at the end of the day. Even with our conference too, just because someone doesn't like one of our speakers, that's fine. Let them speak out against it. Let them blog about it. Let them post about it. That's more than fine. But then you're trying to deplatform a conference you're not even a part of at this point.
Right. Yeah, I mean, what that would have been me saying, okay, I don't think Bill Nye should debate Ken Ham because I have big problems with Ken Ham. And I do. I've met Ken Ham.
So you try to shut down the whole debate.
But I know
that's where the logic goes.
They invited that, right. I'm going to root for Bill Nye, and I think he won. I think he did a really good job there, but that's okay. Hear them out, because in some ways, by not hearing out at least a semi-reasonable side, and the thing is, I met Ken Ham in one of his most fundamental churches. We didn't get hit.
No one
attacked us, right? They gave us some dirty looks and such. You know, we didn't feel the most comfortable in there, but we got a little bit of discussion done, so that's something. You know, just the fact that you can invite Jehovah's Witnesses in to talk, at least we can prove that we can have a calm discussion, don't yell at each other. That's something if we can't find any piece of agreement anywhere else. So, I mean, there's always something. But here, I think people are more centered. I think we're just looking to de-escalate political tensions by finding the humanity, finding the morality in the other person's position, and having a lot of fun at the same time.
Yeah, we're definitely getting closer to the end of our conversation here. So we'll give our last few thoughts on all these topics we're giving in. It is a tricky thing, because like when I look at like your guys' MythCon, I'm sure that most of the people going there are going to be respectful individuals. And there's very few things I see that are off the table. Like saying murdering someone for revenge, that's always going to be bad. There's no debate there. Is Earth flat? It's never going to be flat. But it's looking at the ideologies that people share of if you're questioning, should I associate with them? And outside PR reasons of why you would not want to associate with them, if you want to have an honest, like, progression on the topic, like, and you're deciding, should I give this person a platform? I think you have to deconstruct their core ideologies of what they're going to be speaking about, and then determining from there too. And some of these are more obvious, like maybe the flat earth or the murder or revenge murder are obviously bad. But then say 20 years from now, people start making sex androids, pedophiles start making child sex androids, and then all of a sudden it's like you want to bring a pedophile that's having child sex androids onto your stage. That's something that's like we don't really think about now, but and there'll be people that write off me here, like hearing me say this just now, but they're going to be appalled just by even the suggestion of that. And of course not. And then someone else say like, well, it's not doing any bad. It's helping me prevent me from raping like actual children or having those kind of weird thoughts. And I know that's like a very far-fetched example I'm giving, but it's something that's meant to be that way just to show of like what are the ideologies that people have. And really deconstructing those ideas, like the core principles of their ideology. And then from there on, you can decide, like, do I follow this label? Or is this something I would be willingly subscribe to? Or is this something that I'm not sure about?
Yeah. And definitely, Joe, I think, but you're right in that I was just digging down a little bit more. Like, if you're a white nationalist, white supremacist, right? Yeah, you don't want to platform that. But I think people will get it confused sometimes with civic nationalism. And I don't think that civic nationalism and white, they're not the same thing. You can have a Mexican who is a big civil nationalist, and there's many, many, many Puerto Ricans and Cubans, Americans especially, are huge civic nationalists, and we can't get that confused. And seeing that around, I think that's the problem, is you're the enemy. And especially after Charlottesville, how ugly that was. And led by Spencer, and there were some other groups. But all of those people, and I've listened to a little bit what they've said, is I mean, they really do believe that you need a white majority nation, or maybe even 100% white nation, in order to steward Western liberal democracy. And that's by definition racist, right? It's also ridiculous. What you need is a good culture, and that could be of any race. And they're so worried about, you know, it's not. So yeah, that those events are disgusting, and I think there's people on the left that see that and they wig out, and I get the knee jerk, I really do. And in some ways, not everyone's a Nazi. That's just the bottom line. But we also, I think, what pushes the extremes is if people move out from the center And now, you know, the mid-centers are big. Again, you're always going to have people coming back and forth. So if the right and left have moved farther apart, you're going to get more extremists because we're just pushing people in that direction. I seek to reduce the amount of extremists, and there's extremists on the far left. I don't think that the alt-left is the same thing. There is not really an alt-left, but there is a far left that has a very anti-American ideology. If you look at Antifa, and I've read their stuff. You know, I really do understand where they're coming from. They're very anti-American.
Yeah, just because they stand against something that we can disagree with doesn't mean that you're going to want to, like, approve of something like Antifa. You can admit what you think is worse at for the time being based off their ideologies, but you don't have to praise both sides or say that one side's better in the sense of, like, promoting them more.
Correct. Or I can't remember who said, but I heard someone say it, I think in a video, just because you oppose the Nazis does not mean you're immediately the good guys.
Yeah. You know? The enemy of my enemy is not necessarily my friend.
Correct. So,
and that's definitely true. I mean, they wanted, somebody called him a patriot. And one of them, and it was on Antifa Boston, I think, and they responded back like, F you. We're not patriots. We think America's disgusting. Wow. Okay. And I mean, in that way, you have a lot in common. The people over on the white nationalist side are saying America's disgusting because we're mixing races.
Yeah. You'd
be like, whoa. I mean, these are extremes. And you got to cut those fringes out of the main political discussion and hope somebody could de-radicalize them. So I hope we have a Quilliam Institute in the United States, except for, you know, it's going to be de-radicalizing kind of right and left.
You know, I remember seeing a picture on my Facebook wall, I think it was a couple of days ago, where it was, who was it? Sarah Palin. Sarah Palin posted this meme about Antifa. And it was just, I mean, it was total right-wing garbage at the end of the day. But it was, like, facts about Antifa. They all hate America. 92, I'm not kidding, this is what they literally said. 92% of them are confirmed to live with their own parents. And then they're all supported by the mainstream left. I'm like, what the hell are you talking about? They're supported by the mainstream left. That's literally
it's
like
going over too much. There are those that will paint a little bit rosier view of them than we should. Those that are saying also attacked Nazis without a permit, and then they're showing the people storming Normandy. And yeah, you're comparing it, okay, like Antifa is not, are not the heroes that stormed Omaha Beach.
And I still, I don't know, I wouldn't say that the mainstream left supports them, though.
No.
I think the vast majority of people still condemn the violence at the end of the day.
I think, yeah, there's a certain confusion on, well, they really oppose this. I think that they're being kind of, it's not that the left is supporting them, it's maybe they're turning a blind eye. Some. I think that you could, that's a fair, I mean, it's so new.
That too. And I think a lot of it comes down to, it's a false equivocation on the right too, where you have someone saying, well, Antifa is the right, we'll say the right Nazi party or the right, or the, I mean the left Nazi party, or the left KKK party. And, where you have people who are defending Antifa by saying, because you have people on the right who are saying that the left is just as bad. When Trump said, you know, there was violence and bad decisions on all sides. And people are saying, what the heck are you talking about? You have one side who are literal Nazis and one side who are opposing them. Well, correct. At the end of the day, I would say Antifa is a little bit better than Nazis. But just because I say that does not mean I support Antifa in any means. Mm-hmm. You know, you're taking the best out of a really bad situation there. But I do think, with all this being said, even though we have limits, we have reasons, we have, I guess, differences in where we would draw the line with discussion and all that stuff, to avoid dogmatism, you have to actually try to learn about the other side to some point. You have to go out there, you have to see where they're coming from, realize that they're not all bad people. Some people are. Some people are literally just that batshit crazy, unfortunately. But that a lot of people that you think are these horrible people, or they're categorized by others as these horrible people, are actually miscategorized. Mm-hmm. And they're being told these straw man arguments against them. And the only way to defeat that dogmatism is to actually go out there yourself and see where they're coming from a purely objective point of view. Be fascinated by where they're coming from. Ask tons of questions, not because you want to turn them or change their mind, but because you want to see if they change yours. And be a real skeptic when you are really talking to these people, as in, okay, what you just said was really stupid, but okay, what you just said made absolutely no sense to me whatsoever. Where the heck did you get that from? And I think that's how you end this dogmatism once and for all. It's a lot easier said than done.
Because what you said, that you said it well. You said that doesn't make any sense to me. Mm-hmm. You didn't say it didn't make any sense. You just and there the assumption is, oh, well, let me explain it better. Mm-hmm. You know, it's less offensive than, I don't know, that didn't make any sense.
And maybe even at the end of the day, what they're saying actually made no sense. I mean, when you have someone who's a flat earther and say, all right, let me explain to you better why the earth is flat. It's not going to happen, because what they're saying is just literally irrational. But when you have someone who is talking to you about a more nuanced position, like abortion, like politics, mm-hmm. learn where they're coming from, especially when morals are concerned, learn where they're coming from.
Yeah.
So,
and I think that too, but the numbers, I think the fringes are small, much, much smaller than we think, but we really have to nuance, you know, the center right from white supremacists, which are a tiny fringe. And I really think like Antifa and some of that we have to differentiate that from progressives. You can't lump those two in together either.
Yeah. It's all about that honest conversation, positive intent. And planting those little mind seeds.
Yeah.
But yeah, once you feel that you cannot be manipulated, and once you're sure of it, you've put yourself in the position to be manipulated. So remember that.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a great way to end off this conversation. Thank you so much for having this talk today. I think it was extremely productive, and I think we just gave a lot of people a whole new perspective on these things.
Cool.
Very cool.
Yeah, thanks, Ken.
Thank you.
So before we close on out here, is there anything else, MythCon, that you'd like to promote before we go?
Well, yeah, I mean, the MythCon is going to take place, the Myth Information Conference, September 30th, all day long, starting 10:30, going to 9, plus an after party. So, you know, pack an Adderall or something. I'm kidding. But it's going to be a lot of fun. Chuanhead and Armored are going to talk about social media and how things are different and how they've changed. And I think a lot of social media is definitely exacerbating what we think. Melissa Chen's going to talk. She's from the Global Secular Humanist Movement that's doing a lot of work, bringing some people, atheists and others that are in danger from places like Bangladesh and Pakistan, and bringing them over. And they're doing tons of good work there. Sargon of Akkad is going to debate Thomas Smith, right? And those two, right? We've got one anti-social justice, one is pro-social justice. Hopefully those will have a good conversation. We'll see how much common ground they can find. I really hope there's some. Hopefully there'll be some debates. Hopefully a few minds will be changed in some direction or another. Then Faisal Al-Muhtar is going to debate Asra Nomani. So that's a Muslim reformer in Asra Nomani with Faisal Al-Muhtar, who's an ex-Muslim from Iraq. Faisal is got his green card, but is not yet a citizen, but will be. He would have voted for Hillary. Asra voted for Trump and took a lot of shit for that, right? And we're kind of breaking down why. It'd be very interesting to see if she still would have. I don't know. We're going to interview her in a couple weeks. And then we're following that debate up with Batman and Jesus, the movie, where we're creating, it's a documentary. It's both fun and cool. Lots of people are in it. Richard Carrier, a whole bunch of other scholars, Arne Roth, Seth Andrews. There's a lot of people in that. They're also going to be at the conference. So you're going to get a chance to hang out with Matt Dillahunty doing magic. Seth Andrews is going to be hanging around the crowd, Arne Roth, these babes. So the mix of views is going to be great. And it's really going to be a wide diversity of opinion, which is good. The movie's going to be awesome. We juxtapose, you know, what if we were worshiping Batman in the, you know, 2000 years from now? And how the Batman lore breaks off from the Christian lore, and how it's eerily similar. And that's going to be really good. That's going to premiere. And then after that, after party, it's going to be a blast. All at the Pabst Theater, killer venue. And it's really going to be a good place. And it's going to be a great conference. Join us, $55 a ticket for the thing, $125 if you want the whole thing in the after party. If you're just interested in the movie, I think it's $12. And if you are way far away and you can't possibly come, $5 for a live stream.
very cool. I think a lot of people would come and check that out now.
It's definitely worth it. It's going to be one of the coolest conferences in Milwaukee. We've already got well over 200 sold, and we're hoping to get to like 400, maybe
it's
5.
It's the biggest conference we've ever done so far, so we're excited.
I think it'll be a great success. And yeah, with that, I think that ends our conversation for today. Once again, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
This concludes this episode of Verdant Interviews. If you'd like to hear more interesting conversations with new guests, you can find these discussions on my YouTube channel, Verdant Interviews, on SoundCloud at soundcloud.com/verdantinterviews, or on my Weebly blog at verdantinterviews.weebly.com. You can also follow me on Facebook under the tag @verdantinterviews for other updates and information.